love from love, hope from hope, and peace from peace, our Prince of Peace thereof, who comes forth with the glorious cloud of the splendor of his magnificence. These are the days that the Lord has made. Let us be glad. Welcome to the Dove on Blessings, one of my many readings from my book, Gospel of the Dove. Now it's time for a gospel of blessedness. It's time for a gospel directing all saints to cast away all of their heaviness with Christ's help. So let all sons and daughters of obedience dispel any gloom enveloping the eyes of their minds, since that Lion of Judah now roars out his loudest roar. For that true star of Bethlehem was brought forth in human flesh and agreed to live among men, and by his sacrifice they could ascend towards his Father of lights, to know him, to fear him, seek him, serve him, love him, praise him, and to enjoy him eternally, for he is love, and those who love are born of God and know him because God is love. Nor is there any question that it was preordained that every child of God's light would find themselves lavished with all of the treasures of his grace's power. Crowns of blessings shall be given away, beloved. Even their heads would someday be crowned with an imperial diadem, after they're robed in a white tunic of the most exquisite splendor and girded about with the flashing brilliancy of the Lamb's truth of love, which is always far beyond the comprehension of anyone who hasn't crossed over into our great beyond. Moreover, at the sight of our most lofty Godhead shall every born again, every soul born again with their love on, seemingly feel annihilated and lost in astonishment as they gaze upon the kingdom of God manifesting, while getting it into their spirits that they've always been his heirs and always imagined. And at that wondrous time of the most wonderful wonders to behold, every such child of the kingdom shall never desire anything aside from the fervent love of God, the deepest love of Christ, and the free-spirited love of their everlasting Spirit of Spirits. The long-awaited eternal eighth day comes. Then every knee bowing shall suddenly stand unashamedly before the great white throne, after God imparts to them the amazing knowledge of his hidden sacraments and the perplexing answers to all of his mysterious mysteries that have always been so simple to understand to those of unbounded faith. Evermore shall every prince and princess of Elohim, Adonai, Allah, whatever you want to call them, evermore shall they praise that Trinity of One, for they empowered their souls while they still lived in earthly flesh, thereby freeing children of love from their ongoing slavery of their carnal passions, as they acquired a new power of love over them and through them. But at the long-awaited time of the kingdom's manifestation, the redeemed of the Lord shall eternally see that they themselves, by his great power, were truly transformed into an exact copy of all of his sanctity, the beauty of his honor, the loveliness of his humility, and that they shall, with their love light on, eagerly sing out blessings unto that designer of all during the preceding nightless day of the eighth day, with the utmost promptness and devotion, for that risen body of Christ in love shall inherently possess some unmovable steadfastness of faith in love, and they'll have the certitude of hope, along with the blazing fire of the most volatile kind of divinely passionate love. So it's time to let our love let go. Then shall hallelujah become the constant cry of those finding the justification and salvation of the Lamb, as they continually never cease to be enthralled in their endless love and admiration of Him. So now let all humanity receive the very best news about that lover of love, as they finally realize that only Isa Yeshua Jesus alone asked Himself as God for His promise, a man's deliverance, to come forth. And He has sent His supplications up to paradise. His faith and charity instantaneously penetrated the farthest heavens of the furthest outer places of space. Nor should it be too surprising, since He turned out to be a man most humble and pure, leading a most holy and sincere life, and yet He was most grave, earnest, and incomparably modest and honest. Jesus became the song that they sang. It's no wonder that countless multitudes would eventually become abandoned to Christ, since they were predestined to spring forth as living miracles from His amazing wellspring of eternal serenity. Furthermore, those same servants of our faithful and true One would then come to the awesome place where they wouldn't have any real desire for anything aside from becoming lost within His purity of love. For it was inevitable that the thoughts about that second Adam would flood over them like some strong waves of peace, while their crests crashed down onto their souls hard enough to rapidly wash away most of their former fears and anxiety. And for the love of Jesus and all that's sacred, let God's children now realize that they need no other word about love other than the Lord's unconditional love found in the Kingdom Age New Covenant, identified correctly for the latter days, written for all mankind, Jeremiah 32:27. So now I bring forth a new sort of the spirit of prophecy and an Arabian dagger of truth, and it's time for love to shine, people.